please give a humongous warm welcome to Hossein Zargartalebi.
I was born and raised in a close-knit, crowded family that deeply believed in education, science, and taking care of one another. And in the middle of that beautiful chaos, my older brother stood out. He was everything to me, my mentor, my role model, the person I looked up to the most. He was brilliant, kind, and full of life. But about 10 years ago, I watched that life fade away. At just 30 years old, he was diagnosed with a rare blood disease. And the last 6 months of his life, he was confined to the hospital room, hooked up with machines, surrounded by tubes, and stuck with needles multiple times a day. Every day after work, I would jump on a bus, rush to the hospital, just to sit beside him, just to be with him. The doctors worked tirelessly, but on that time, to figure out how to help him, they had to run test after test, send samples to the lab, and wait. They took blood samples over and over, trying to guess what was happening, but the tests weren't fast enough. They couldn't see enough. They couldn't see the immune storms, the shifts in inflammation, the signs of infection, the subtle changes in the protein levels that were telling the real story. They were chasing shadows, not signals. And in the end, we lost him. Not because medicine failed, but because we didn't have a way to understand his biology in real time. That moment broke something in me. But it also sparked something else. It gave me one question I couldn't stop asking. Could we have saved my brother's life if he could have heard the faintest signals of his body? Not with needles, not with delays, but continuously. Like listening to a heartbeat, only much quieter. Like listening to a whisper before it turns into a scream. That question became my compass. I started in Iran, then Canada, and eventually arrived in Chicago chasing one goal: to find a way to understand what body is saying in real time, not isolated snapshots. As I got deeper into research, I started learning what biosensors could and couldn't do. Biosensors are tiny devices that can measure chemical and biological signals, things like glucose, hormones, and oxygen, and translate them into data we can understand. You have seen this in smartwatches monitoring heartbeat and breathing. Let's call them loud signals. They are easy to detect because they shout. But there are also some faint signals, tiny, subtle, and incredibly important. Think of the difference between hearing a train pass by and trying to hear the flutter of bird's wings from across the field. Those faint signals, those are proteins. They are the body's messengers. They tell us when something is wrong long before symptoms appear, if only we could hear them. In our lab, in Kelly Lab, we developed a specific type of biosensors called molecular pendulums. Here is how it works. A DNA-based sensor or molecular pendulum is attached to the electrode. And when we apply a potential to the electrode, we bring that sensor to the surface and capture its electrical signal as the baseline. And when the target protein comes close to the sensor, it binds to it, and this interaction changes the electrical signal. And this is how we detect when something is there. But there was a problem. The proteins wouldn't let go. Normally, in real-time monitoring, a target molecule binds to the sensor, gets detected, and then detaches so the sensor can hear again. But proteins, they cling. Like a sound that keeps echoing, drowning out everything else. Without a way to reset, the sensor gets stuck, deaf to what's coming next. And I knew that wasn't enough. We needed a way to hear again and again. We needed a breakthrough. For years, I was stuck in one question. How do we get protein off the sensors? Proteins are sticky by design. That's what makes them effective. But it also makes them stubborn. If you want real-time data, we need to break that stubborn bound. So, one windy afternoon, I was walking home from the lab, tired, still thinking about the problem. And I stopped at the crosswalk, watching trees bending in the wind and branches swaying with rhythm. And then I noticed that leaves twisting free from the branches and floating to the ground. It wasn't dramatic, but it clicked. A leaf doesn't fall unless something nudges it free. What's built to stay needs force to break. And I realized maybe we don't have to wait hours for a protein to detach. What if we apply a tiny oscillation, a little vibration to the sensor, only enough energy to shake the protein loose? If that worked, we could reset the sensor again and again. Measure, reset, and measure again. That was the idea I carried back to the lab. I spent months optimizing the sensor, and one night in the lab, it happened. I applied a tiny control oscillating voltage to the electrode, and the signal dropped. The protein had let go. The sensor was clean, ready to measure again. It was like I had gently shaken the sensor, only enough wind to make the leaf fall. Everything around me faded. No sound, no movement, only tears quietly filling my eyes, as if my body understood the moment before my mind did. Because in that moment, I wasn't looking at data. I was seeing my brother. I was seeing every patient who suffered in silence, waiting for lab results that always came too late. And somehow, in that silence, I felt something shift. We had given biology a voice. But a lab discovery isn't enough. It's something to see a signal in the screen. It's another to make that signal matter in someone's life. To see if this truly worked in the real world, we need to build something small, something implantable that could be worn like a patch that sits into the skin for in-body measurement. So we developed an electrode-integrated microneedle device, small, simple, and powerful. It just slips beneath the skin and draws interstitial fluid, the liquid between our cells, without any pain or blood. And in that fluid, it listens. It listens to cytokines, proteins involved in the inflammation, tracking them in real time. No labs, no delays, and no guessing. Why that matters? Most of the time, when we notice inflammation, it's already caused damage. But when we can see it starting before symptoms appear, we can act early, adjust treatment in real time, and possibly stop disease in its tracks. It's like watching a storm form instead of only seeing the destruction afterwards. We tested this in diabetic animals, watching inflammation unfold, tracking body's response to fasting, insulin, and even infections with minutes resolution updates. It was the first time we could hear body speaks in moments, not days, like placing a microphone inside the body to capture its quietest signals, those whispers that usually go unheard. It isn't just a tool, it's a window into life itself. Here is the thing about proteins. There are about a million different forms of them in the human body. Each one tells a story, revealing what's happening deep inside us. Inflammation is just an example. Today, we know of over 1,000 protein biomarkers linked to the diseases like cancer, heart disease, infections, and autoimmune conditions. And until now, it was impossible to track them in real time. It was like we have been trying to listen to the body with earplugs in. But this technology changes that. It gives us the opportunity to hear the full symphony, where every protein is an instrument playing its part in a score of health and disease. Together, as a part of an incredible team led by Professor Shaina Kelly, we published this work in Science last year. And since then, dozens of research groups around the world have begun adapting it, exploring new proteins, new diseases, and new opportunities. And since this sensor is made of the materials that are affordable and scalable, it's not a distant dream. It's something we can soon carry with us, turning biology into something we can finally hear. It all started in a hospital room in Iran, watching someone I loved fade while no one could explain why. That's something I will never forget. My brother's story gave this work its purpose. But it isn't about just one life. It's about all lives we can reach. It's about replacing guesswork with action, replacing waiting with action, replacing guesswork with clarity, and giving people back the most fragile and powerful thing of all, time. Time to act early, time to recover fully, time to live, not as patients, but as people. That's the future I believe in. And that's the future I hope this world brings to life. Thank you.